I hope I'm not going to make you cry, but just before I start, this reminds me a little bit of when I was in a previous life as a Home Affairs editor covering the Home Office, and I addressed a lecture room full of personal injury lawyers, and I was asked to be provocative in order to stimulate debate and generate responses from them. By the end of it, I thought I was likely to get personal injury from some of them myself. That's almost be smuggled out the back door. So I hope you don't take this too personally. It may be a little bit challenging, but I hope you'll find it's food for thought. This year has been a public relations disaster for the PR industry. If you'd walked down any high street at the start of 2014 and asked people to name Britain's most famous PR professional, the most common answer would have been Max Clifford. Probably would be even now. As it is, he's serving an 8-year term for abusing his privileged position in the communications sector to exploit vulnerable young people. So who else is famous in PR? Well, the second most high-profile figure in the business at this moment is Andy Coulson, another comms professional doing time at Her Majesty's pleasure, 18 months in his case. There are other well-known PRs, of course there are. Matthew Freud is famous not only as the great-grandson of Sigmund Freud, but as the son-in-law of Rupert Murdoch through his marriage to the media mogul's daughter Elizabeth. Matthew, or Saint Matthew of the Shadows, as he's been called for his ability to exert influence without being publicly identified, has, like Andy Coulson, found himself dragged into the spotlight in the recent phone hacking trial. It was Freud who played a key role in assembling the so-called Chipping Norton set, the cabal of politicians and senior media figures who met for garden parties in the Cotswolds and carved up power between them. Such high-level networking is a commendable talent for a PR man. But the way the story emerged, first at the Leveson inquiry and then at the Old Bailey trial, was damaging to Freud's own reputation and that of the PR industry as a whole. Who else? Tim Bell? Margaret Thatcher's favourite PR? I know from experience he's incredibly charming and wonderful company. He was much in the news when Baroness Thatcher died last year. But those who follow Lord Bell's career know that he's happy to represent dictators such as the late Augusto Pinochet of Chile and authoritarian regimes such as that in Belarus. His view is that rather like in a court of law, everyone's entitled to representation. Presumably he'd have spun for Max Clifford if he could afford the fees. How about Alistair Campbell? I've spent time with him too, in the kitchen of his home in London, discussing the intersection of politics and media. He's very impressive and deeply motivated. But for most people, he's indelibly tainted with the spinning of the war in Iraq. And the emerging civil war in that country means there's little prospect of him escaping from that legacy at the moment. It hasn't been a good start to 2014 for Alistair either. So here's the problem for PR. It has no public champions. Other than those I've already mentioned, I can't think of a single figure in the business with the box office appeal to host a TV show or the visibility to be recognised by strangers in the aisles of Sainsbury's. You might be able to put me right on that. The advertising industry has a similar issue. There aren't many galacticos in UK ad land beyond the likes of Sir Martin Sorrell, Maurice Sarchi, John Hegarty, but at least none of those have been sent to jail. How dare you, I can hear some of you thinking, a journalist looking down his nose at PR after the iniquities that were going on at Britain's biggest selling newspaper and other papers besides. Fair point. Look, I'm not seeking to do a Robert Peston here. As Glenn mentioned a little bit earlier, the BBC economics editor last month made an extraordinary attack on PR, saying that PRs were professional bullshitters. Delivering the Charles Wheeler lecture for the British Journalism Review, he slated the comms industry as the enemy of those seeking to report the news. In his disparaging comments, Peston said, the fact about himself that the bullshitter hides is that the truth values of his side of the The fact about himself that the bullshitter hides is that the truth, values of his statements are of no central interest to him. The bullshitter is neither on the side of the true nor on the side of the false. His eye is not on the facts at all, as the eyes of the honest man and of the liar are, except insofar as they may be pertinent to his interest with getting away with what he says. Very strong words, don't necessarily agree with them. But Mr. Pesson has influence. If you work in the PR industry or have aspirations to do so, you might reject these criticisms, I'm sure you would. But Mr. Pesson has a fine reputation built on his exposure of the failings of the banks in 2008. The public trust what he says, and the PR industry has no equivalent voice to refute his claims. For an industry built on reputation management, this is an extraordinary state of affairs. The news media, by its very nature, creates household name figures who can speak with authority. Aside from Pesson, the BBC offers the likes of my old editor Andrew Marr, David Dimbleby, and until recently Jeremy Paxman. There's John Snow and Kathy Newman on Channel 4 News. Radio has John Humphreys, Michelle Hussein, and the Today presenting team. And the press have figures ranging from Alan Rusbridger, editor-in-chief of The Guardian, and that paper's investigative reporter Nick Davies, to my paper's Middle East expert Robert Fisk, and, depending on your taste, commentators from Matthew Paris and Yasmin Alibi Brown to Rod Little and Katie Hopkins. They're all known to the public and have a platform to speak out. PR doesn't have this voice or profile. Does this matter? I don't agree with Robert Pesson that comms is locked into an adversarial struggle with news, so I don't suggest the industry needs someone to stand up and respond to every news bulletin and press column. But PR does need high-profile advocates to explain more clearly how it works. Otherwise, that role will fall to fictional media, the sitcom writers and the movie producers. Up until now, there's been a paucity of films and television shows dealing with PR, and most of them have treated the craft with scant respect. The most famous television PR is Malcolm Tucker from the BBC's political satire, The Thick of It. Supposedly inspired by Ali Campbell and played by Peter Capaldi, Tucker is an uncouth bully. We'll see him here, I think. Oh, okay. I'm sure many of you are already familiar with his memorable turns of phrase. Should we skip it?
Well, we could, and then it would stop playing the minute you start.
I'll carry on if that's all right. I think we've all seen The Thick of It, and Malcolm Tucker's turning the air blue with his dreadful language and aggressive approach. No one other than a psychopath would watch him and think, yes, that's what I want to do for a living. So sit now. For those of you not had the pleasure, it's a brilliant series. I'm a big fan.
Usually the phrase I'm not threatening you but is followed by a threat.
I'm sorry, Malcolm, I'm really sorry.
Fuck's sake, Jesus! Mate, well, now we've got another fucking adjective to add to fucking smug and glum, haven't we? Fucking retarded! Jesus Christ, do you not think it would be germane to check who you're talking to? It's a fucking newspaper office! Is that a fucking sanatorium for the fucking deaf? Is it? Are you so dense? I'm not gonna have to run around slapping badges on people with a big tick on some and a big cross on others so you know when to shut your gob and when to open it. Jesus Christ. Oh, but that'll probably confuse you as well, won't it? That'd be too confusing. You'll see the cross and go, oh fuck, X marks the spot. Better tell this little person all about the Prime Minister's fucking catastrophic erectile dysfunction. Oh, but not to worry. Not to worry. You've sent fucking Ollie over there to deal with it. Fucking Ollie! He's a fucking knitted scarf at twice, a fucking balaclava.
Well, you're on very shaky legal ground there.
No,
that's Malcolm Tucker. As I say, no one other than a psychopath would watch him and think that's what I want to do for a living. The other obvious example of a programme about public relations on British television is the long-running series Absolutely Fabulous, which is reputedly inspired by the business career of Lynn Franks, who was for a time the nation's most famous female PR. I'd have thought that even comms professionals with a great sense of humour and a willingness to laugh at themselves would have found a Dina Monsoon and Patsy Stone a hard watch. The line I remember best is the one from Adina's oh-so-serious daughter, Safi, who asks her mother about her job. Great.
PR! Yes, but PR! I PR things!
Lulu!
No, no! I PR them! I am, and if you've heard of me, I have PR. I make the fabulous, I make the crap into credible, I make the dull into delicious.
Delicious!
I PR, darling, and...
I'm sure you're all a lot clearer after that. It must be excruciating stuff for an industry which wants to be seen as professional and which wants a place at the boardroom table. Before Adina and Patsy, some of the most popular television treatments of PR was in the 70s show Some Mothers Do Have 'Em. I don't know how many people remember that. I unfortunately do go back that far. In one episode, the hapless Frank Spencer, who was played by Michael Crawford, great actor, attempted to join the communications industry. Starting at 18, I think, 1830. Here he is on his PR call.
What does a PRO do all the time? What must he do that begins with P? P. P. E. P-E-R-S.
Perspires.
No, he does not perspire.
Well, he does do just a bit.
No, he doesn't.
Well, on a hot day...
Persuade. That's the key word. Friendly persuasion. Friendliness. That's the word.
The PR world has moved on a lot since the 70s. Most members of the public have grasped the basics of the job and work for organisations where they're required to involve the press office in any form of external communications. But there's a difference between knowing you have to refer media inquiries to the press office and understanding the breadth of the PR's role, valuing it even. Where's PR's equivalent of Mad Men, a show of such hypnotic style and wonderful acting that it not only provided almost documentary-level insight into the genesis of Madison Avenue agencies and modern advertising, it also made Adland look like a fantastic place to work. What a film. As with television, the movies have not been very sympathetic or helpful in setting out the role of PR. Lists of the top 10 films for PR posted online don't seem to contain any flicks which lionise the job of public relations professional or cast a PR in the starring role. According to Business Insider website, the film that tops its list is Jerry Maguire. from the immortal show me the money lines to the disputes with other agents trying to steal his clients, his hard work for his clients and pushing them on marketing, there are many transferable skills from this movie for those of us in PR, says Business Insider. In actual fact, the Jerry Maguire character played by Tom Cruise is a sports agent. He's less obviously a PR than either Max Clifford or Andy Coulson, who the industry has been doing its best to disown. Other top PR films are Thank You for Smoking, which featured Aaron Eckhart as the chief spokesman for Big Tobacco, lobbying on behalf of the cigarette companies while trying to remain a role model for his 12-year-old son. Then there are movies about political spin doctors such as Primary Colours, the story of Bill Clinton's 1992 presidential campaign starring John Travolta and featuring Maura Tierney as his spokeswoman. In Frost Nixon, the great Ron Howard movie of one of the greatest media moments in modern political history, one of the most intriguing characters is Irving Swifty Lazar, the great American publicist who played a key role in persuading President Richard Nixon to give a series of interviews to the British broadcaster David Frost. I talked to Sir David about the extraordinary process of setting up those interviews, which no one thought possible in the wake of the Watergate scandal that brought Nixon down. Winning the confidence of Lazar was essential to that process because the disgraced president trusted the publicist who believed Nixon would be able to outwit Frost and improve his standing with the American public by giving the interviews to a nationwide network of cable channels. But it's the journalist character played by Martin Sheen who is the hero of the story, just as David Frost was in real life. Swifty Lazar is not so well remembered. The lasting stigma attached to Richard Nixon suggests his PR strategy on this particular issue was not a successful one. Elsewhere in the same list is All the President's Men, the original Watergate movie starring Robert Redford and Dustin Hoffman as the Washington Post reporters Woodward and Bernstein, who brought Nixon to book in the first place. I recently interviewed Kathy Newman, the Channel 4 News presenter, and she told me this film had persuaded her to become a journalist. We were talking in the office of Ben DePere, the editor of Channel 4 News, and he came into the room at one point and made a jokey comment that Kathy should tell me that her original motivation was from All the President's Men. And with some embarrassment, she had to admit that she'd already said that, and it really was. That film has become so influential in launching the careers of journalists, it's become a cliche. According to Business Insider, All the President's Men offers many useful tips any crisis PR agency can learn from. This is true, but it's not in any way a celebration of PR, or even about PR. Where are PR's heroic stories? Most of us in this room know that modern communications comprises professionals with a wide range of specialist skills. It's not a case of simply answering phone calls from journalists. Those were the old days. PR is attracting high-flying graduates in a way it wasn't a generation ago. The PR industry is growing. It's up to nearly £10 billion sector in the UK last year, an increase of £2 billion on the previous year. Companies have poured money into communications in the 27 years since I came into journalism, reflecting the growing awareness of the value of public reputation. But if new recruits are to be attracted by more than the salary offers and have a real sense of vocation, then PR needs to set out its own stall. Somehow, the many decent professional people in the PR world need to take control of their own narrative. It can't be that difficult. It's what they try and do in their daily working lives. All of us with a close knowledge of the sector know who the real big hitters are. City players such as Roland Rudd of Finsbury, Alan Parker of Brunswick, John Waples of FTI. None of them are very much known to the public. Craig Oliver as Coulson's role in Downing Street, but a fraction of the profile. Jackie Brock Doyle headed the comms operation for the London Olympics and now runs good relations for Chime. But she doesn't get the public recognition of someone like Roger Mosey, who headed the BBC's coverage of the Games. Incredibly, despite the wealth of talent and expertise at the top of the PR sector, Max Clifford was allowed to fill the vortex between absolutely fabulous and the real-life world of modern PR by dominating media coverage of the sector for decades. Max was loved by journalists because he always returned calls promptly and gave great sound bites, not just on the entertainment world in which he operated, but on wider themes of reputation management as well. While other high-ranking PRs preferred to think of themselves as strategic comms specialists and clung to the coattails of the CEOs, leaving the business of media relations to their junior colleagues, Max was always talking to the press. I actually spoke to him once after he was arrested, and it was clear he was terrified that the calls from journalists were drying up, and I actually found myself having to get him off the phone. There will be people in the sector who will try to distance Andy Coulson from PR too. They'll point out that his criminal activity occurred during his career as a journalist and not while he was director of communications at Downing Street. This is true. But for 7 years as one of Britain's most high-profile PR figures, he lied and lied about his past criminal activities. I'm pleased to see that the PRCA Director General Francis Ingham has been smart enough to acknowledge that his conviction once again casts the industry in a bad light. When Clifford was sentenced in May, the Public Relations Consultants Association surveyed a shocked industry to try to gauge the damage done. One of the most sensible responses, in my view, came from Mark Stringer, the founder of the Pretty Green Agency. If we're being honest, he said, most of us would have said that Max Clifford was one of the best there was at generating and securing stories for his clients. We might not have agreed with the way he went about it, but we were often in awe of what he delivered for his clients. Now, understandably, everyone is distancing themselves from him. But let's not now try and also rewrite history because it makes us feel so uncomfortable. Others, however, tried to claim that Max was not actually a PR man at all. As one agency chief put it, for the vast majority, I think, Clifford was viewed as being a high-profile talent publicist without being deeply associated with the wider communications industry. He was also viewed as a keen self-publicist with his own agenda. As a consequence, the impact to the industry, I think, is negligible. Well, I can't agree with that last comment. Yes, I'm sure that most people in the PR business saw Max as something other, inhabiting a world that they barely recognised. But the same does not hold true for the public at large. Press cuttings from before Clifford's arrest show him described variously as a PR mastermind, a PR guru, a PR mogul, and a PR supremo. This may be misleading reporting by Clifford's admirers in the press, but that's the impression that the public was left with. And to say the industry is unaffected by his spectacular demise seems extraordinarily complacent from a business which prides itself on its sensitivity to reputational threats. Publicity seekers like Clifford should never again be given the freedom to dominate the industry's profile, such as he did. As one comms professional told the survey, the industry has let itself down by not regulating enough and allowing people to so easily establish themselves as high-profile PR experts without having enough of a quality control or code of ethics in place. PR can't leave its own story to Max Clifford or Robert Peston or Malcolm Tucker or Adina Monsoon. PRs are supposed to be storytellers. The final line of the film, Thank You for Not Smoking, features Aaron Eckhart, tobacco lobbyist, saying, Michael Jordan plays ball, Charles Manson kills people, I talk. Everybody has a talent, and PR needs to talk some more, and to find a way to write its own scripts. And I don't mean more dull handbooks on brand management, which I get sent two or three of every week. It needs its champions to appear on Question Time. And today, explaining what it is that PRs do, beyond the ab-fab definition of IPR things, sweetie. It needs television formats which take the business of PR to centre stage. And it needs films in which PRs are not just central protagonists, but also the good guys. Journalists are not going to write these scripts. But if PRs are the storytellers they claim to be, and if their role is as important as is made out, it can't be beyond this industry's wit to tell its own tale.